so, who does not have a sheet? If you don't have a sheet, please raise your hand. Doug's got them over here. Good. As I said last week, as we move forward through the book, I'm going to continue to add to this sheet to try to help us visualize the when question, right? A lot of people go to the book of Revelation as if it's a book about when. When is this going to happen? I am going to maintain that it is not a book about when, it's a book about who and what. Yeah? Who, Jesus, what saves the world? The when question is not at the front of John's mind. It's there, but it's kind of buried behind a bunch of stuff. And so again, this sheet is trying to say, and propose at least, that everything that we're seeing, or most of what we're seeing, as opposed to being, if you're looking at a timeline, where you have beginning of the world and the end of the world, fall into sin and end of the world, as opposed to being a book about, like, on the last little nugget over here of chaos that happens, that it is a book predominantly about the entire period of the existence of the human race, from the fall onward at least. Now, Wright, in the commentary I've recommended, which I still say is the best one you'll ever find, he maintains that it's actually this period, from Jesus' ascension to his return. I disagree with him. I don't think it's a matter of damnation if you disagree with me on that one or not. But that's a very different position to take, and that this is just a book to give us a blueprint for how to see when the end of the world is coming, thereby ignoring our Lord's words and we know that they are now. To recover, to recap that from last week, or the last few weeks, you got Jesus outside of time and space giving John this vision of himself and saying, I'm going to give you this vision, this chapter 1. And it starts with these letters that he writes to the churches in the first century. Like this little section of letters going on right here. John, you know, John's down in here as well. But he's kind of taken up into this out of time and space heaven. And he sees this image of this lamb in the middle of the throne room. He's going to open a book that is sealed. And from that book that is sealed, you have this revelation that takes place after this, which is chapters 5 and following. And I believe that this is all outside of time. If you want to put it before time, that's fine. It kind of is what I'm doing on the chart. Don't get too like newspaper history timeline with that idea. The bigger idea that John is pointing out is that if you want to understand history at all, there's only one way to enter history, and that's through the Lamb who was slain. There's only one way to enter the book of God's revelation, period, not just Revelation of St. John, the Bible, God's Word, that is through the Lamb who was slain. So the Lamb is the opener of the seals of the mysteries of God. You want to know who God is, you got to go to the Lamb. Yeah? And then the Lamb begins to open these seals. And there's 7 seals on this book. And what we see these seals representing are not just kind of things about the end of the world, they're things that have always been here. You got tyranny. I'm not going to write them in here, but you got them on the sheet for me. You got war comes out of tyranny. You got famine is caused by war, and you got death is caused by all of these things put together. And this should really push all the way through this entire period. But the result of this in the church is the death of those in the faith. And I'm losing what number 6 is. And the result of this is that this is all moving toward an end. And I can't even spell end right. Look at that. An end of all things. Yeah? That was what we got to last week in these 6 first seals, and then this 7th seal opens. But the world has just kind of had this cataclysmic ending, and the sky was rolled up like a scroll, right? It's over. Well, so what time period are we dealing with? We're dealing with the same time period from a different perspective. You have looked at the book of Revelation from this direction, and now we're going to look at it from this direction. Yeah? As to what these 3/7 directions or perspectives are, I'm still working on that one. So if you got ideas about it, you can share them with me. Not today, I have to fly out of here today. But otherwise, I'm still leaving on the sheet the 7 seals as being the fall of man, the fall of humankind, God's image in creation, in which the other seals are going to be included. This is important too, because the 7th seal is going to be this whole next section. Number seven creates the next group of sevens, which is the seven trumpets, these trumpet blowing angels. As to what the purpose of that is, I'm still not sure how it distinguishes from the fall of man, other than seeing kind of the effects of what is going to happen on nature itself. But it goes deeper than nature too, as you're going to see. It gets to not just earth, but to heaven. I'm going to try to pull that apart and explain it as we go. I guess if I had to really say it, though, what is being set up now in this next period is John is going to start placing into this context of the fallen world more fallen things, and then he's going to tell the story. He's actually going to get up here and tell this history. But he's going to tell this history in a way that we normally wouldn't hear it told. That's going to be next week. That's chapters, whatever's after this, 10 and 11. All right, hopefully I'll try to make more sense of that as we go forward. Again, our time is really short, so we're just going to be pressed. Let's dig through these two chapters, Revelation 8 and 9, before you figure out that's where we are. Yeah. All right. When the Lamb opened the seventh seal, there was silence in heaven for about half an hour. Then I saw the seven angels who stand before God, and the seven trumpets, and seven trumpets were given to them. And another angel came and stood at the altar with a golden censer, and he was given much incense to offer with the prayers of all the saints on the golden altar before the throne. And the smoke of the incense with the prayers of the saints rose before God from the hand of the angel. Then the angel took the censer and filled it with fire from the altar and threw it on the earth. And there were peals of thunder, rumblings, flashings of light, and an earthquake. Now the seven angels who had the seven trumpets prepared to blow them. The first angel blew his trumpet, and there followed hail and fire mixed with blood. And these were thrown upon the earth. And a third of the earth was burned up, and a third of the trees were burned up, and all green grass was burned up. The second angel blew his trumpet, and something like a great mountain burning with fire was thrown into the sea. And a third of the sea became blood, and a third of the living creatures in the sea died, and a third of the ships were destroyed. The third angel blew his trumpet, and a great star fell from heaven, blazing like a torch. And it fell on a third of the rivers and on the springs of water. The name of the star is Wormwood. A third of the waters became wormwood, and many people died from the water because it had been made bitter. The fourth angel blew his trumpet, and a third of the sun was struck, and a third of the moon, and a third of the stars, so that a third of their light might be darkened, and a third of the day might be kept from shining, and likewise a third of the night. Then I looked, and I heard an eagle crying with a loud voice as it flew directly overhead, "Woe, woe, woe to those who dwell on the earth at the blast of the other trumpets that the three angels are about to blow." Now I'm going to stop there and just try to pull that apart, and then we'll push forward. We're going to get through the other chapter two. First thing I want you to notice, though, let me double check on this. Just flip back to chapter 6, verse 12. This is what has just happened with the sixth seal. Before this seal, the seventh seal is open, the sixth seal is open. When he opened the sixth seal, I looked, and behold, there was a great earthquake. The sun became black as sackcloth, the full moon became like blood, the stars of the sky fell to the earth. Fig tree sheds its winter fruit when shaken by a gale. Now, flip back to chapter 8. Verse 7. First angel blew his trumpet, followed hail and fire, mixed with blood. The earth was burned. And then, verse 12. Before the angel blew his trumpet, a third of the sun was struck through the moon and the stars. Notice the same language. Yeah? It's not new. He is re-emphasizing exactly what has already happened. But there are four things in these first four trumpet blasts that really change. And everything kind of revolves around each of these individual things that change. What doesn't change is that a third of something has something happen to it in each case. And we talked about this last week too. I can't just remember the verse off head, but one hand. But there was a third of something else that happened last week. We talked about how this is saying that it's a massive amount, but not all of it. And it's a symbolic way of talking about, at any given time, lots of this is happening. If I recall last week, it was just death in general is what was being talked about. Yeah. At any given time on planet Earth, a third of us are about to die, kind of, you know, a large number of us are dying. Now, similarly here, each of these a thirds is saying that there is this constant ongoing tribulation. Right? Which is what this is all about. Great tribulation of mankind as broken creature. And the results of this then begin now, really, with the exception of the sixth seal where the sun and everything is ending. This is the first time that we're going to see that this tribulation is affecting not just man, but those who are under man. In the first trumpet, verse 7 again, it is thrown upon the earth. And these symbols I'm doing up here, you know, I'm still wrestling with how best to paint this idea because there's overlap that's going to start taking place. But trumpet number one is the earth. The earth has a third of its existence just ruined. Even the poor trees can't get out of it. Now, what are the trees? Who did a tree ever harm? It's not quite a fair question. When they fall down, they can't do some damage. But it's not their fault. They got blown over by the wind, right? Poor trees getting burned up. All the green grass. The second angel is a third of the sea. So now you have earth and sea, which are not separate from each other, right? So in one sense, you have all of creation itself as earth being represented by these first two trumpets. And notice again, if I just say, it's the first four trumpets that go together, which is very clear, because the eagle vulture comes in and says something. What's the number four about anyone?
Earth.
Yeah, it's the number of the earth. So, you have earth as a big concept. Now we got land and sea being in constant tribulation. And then something a little different happens in the third angel. Now it's not any particular thing. I suppose you could put the emphasis on the rivers, but I think you'd be hard pressed to say that's the big word that jumps out to you from the little section. What word jumps out to you?
Star.
Single star with a name. Right? And translating it as wormwood is just—it's a mistake. It can mean wormwood. Wormwood is a flower. It's a bitter flower, and the word can mean that. But the word means that because the name of the flower is the word bitterness. Yeah? And so they started to call it, like if I called a rose, it smells good. Yeah? And then later someone comes along and says, your name smells good. And you didn't read, or no, your name's Rose. Right? And so the language, moving from different languages, you lose that the real emphasis here is not on the sound wormwood, right, or the flower, but on what the flower does, which it turns all these rivers bitter, because the name of the flower is bitterness. No, that's not a flower. It's a star. It's a single star falling out of heaven. Now, let's just have that idea hover for a minute. It's going to come back. But this star, I'm going to propose, affects everything. Bitterness. Personified as a person, an identity. We'll come back to that. But then with bitterness comes something else. You're going to have to hold on to this too. Now it's a third of the sun. Can you imagine how a third of the sun, it's like a pie chart. A third of the sun, a third of the moon, and then a third of the stars, so that light is not what it should be. Now, to make it simple, we can just put this as overlap here again, the heavens. But just hold on to that idea, because when the Bible uses the phrase heavens, it doesn't just mean stars. Yeah? The next trumpets are going to make this really, really obvious. Alright, now, before we go to that then, hopefully what's on the sheet that I've now got up here is starting to make sense. And what I want you to see, and I did this on purpose, I am putting this toward the front. Because all of this is very connected directly to the idea of the fall itself. That at the moment of Adam's transgression, all of this is happening suddenly. Now a third of everything's ruined. Bitterness has come upon the earth. Now there's a couple other pieces that we haven't touched on though. There's all that stuff in 8:8:1 and falling, the silence in heaven for about half an hour. Brighton has no clue what it means. I'm not sure I do either. There's some ideas about maybe it is a transition period because he's been talking about paradise, which is on the sheet over here, right, with 144,000. And so the idea of heaven's rest, a Sabbath rest, could be a day of silence. It doesn't really convince me that that's right, but I'm not sure I have a real answer for what it does mean. Other than that there's a very clear transition taking place, it's kind of the other possible answer. He's moving from seals to trumpets, which is what's happening here. And in the middle of this transition, you got these angels giving the trumpets, but then it pauses again, and there's this other angel that comes out of nowhere. And as to the identity of the other angel, there's no agreement in interpretation as to who this angel is. What's clear is that the angel speaks for the martyrs. Because he takes the prayers of the martyrs, their incense, which goes back to the fifth seal, right? And he speaks for them, represents them at that altar where they all are. And they're all praying. If you remember, what were they praying for? How long, O Lord, until you do what? Yeah, bring the wrath. Bring the wrath. And then this angel goes and he takes fire from the altar and he casts it down upon the earth. And it's all burned up. Everything ends again. So if there's an end in the seven, a final end in the seven seals, that's it right there. But then it opens up this whole other thing with the trumpets again. Yeah? So you have two things taking place, but the fire is finally cast upon the earth. It makes a breaking point right here. God, and they're praying. How long? So their prayer is now answered. It's over. And then look, here's this new thing again. Saul starting again, and a third of everything's ruined. So John's spinning to take us in a different direction for the perspective on the trumpets, or from the trumpets. Last piece, 13 and following. He hears the eagle. The word is a singular word that means giant bird of prey, and almost always means either eagle or vulture. And which one you decide to have a mean will have a lot more to do with what you think it represents in the text, which makes it difficult, right? You've got to interpret the word before you can read the word to interpret the word. Makes sense. Yeah? Eagle is gone with, because of, in the history of interpretation, is connected to the four living creatures, one of whom looks like an eagle, which is a more clear word for eagle. I don't think eagle is correct. Eagles are majestic and full of life. What this one is proclaiming is something very different, something that maybe a carrion bird would be very happy about. So I think it's a vulture. You know, give or take. The point is what he's proclaiming is going to happen now. That whatever is going on here in this, in the earth and sea and the heavens as we see them normally, is nothing. What's next is the problem, so great that we will even call it the woes. The three great woes. He says it, woe, woe, woe. And as each one goes, there's going to be another messenger coming and saying, the first woe is past, wait for the second. The second woe is past, wait for the third. And then the third, it never even talks about, but it's probably the last trumpet. But it never actually says, this is the third woe, which is interesting in its own way. All right, so. Not normal questions, but anybody just completely confused? All right, let's keep going. Chapter 9. And the fifth angel blew his trumpet, and I saw a star fallen from heaven to earth, and he was given the key to the shaft of the bottomless pit. He opened the shaft of the bottomless pit, and from the shaft was smoke, like the smoke of a great furnace. And the sun and the air were darkened with smoke from the shaft. Then from the smoke came locusts on the earth, and they were given power, like the power of scorpions of the earth. They were told not to harm the grass of the earth or any green plant or tree, but only those people who do not have the seal of God on their foreheads. They were allowed to torment them for 5 months, but not to kill them.
And their torment was like the torment of a scorpion when it stings someone. And in those days, people will seek death and will not find it. They will long to die, but death will flee from them. In appearance, the locusts were like horses prepared for battle. On their heads wore what looked like crowns of gold. Their faces were like human faces, their hair like women's hair, and their teeth like lions' teeth. They had breastplates like breastplates of iron, and the noise of their wings was like the noise of many chariots and horses rushing into battle. Sounds like an Apache helicopter, right? It doesn't, but it's interesting. Some of those who would propose that they only take the Bible literally, when they get to this verse, that's what they'll tell you it means. It's kind of a fascinating move to me. And we'll come back to that. They have tails and stings like scorpions, and their power to hurt people for 5 months is in their tails. They have as a king over them the angel of the bottomless pit. His name in Hebrew is Abaddon, and in Greek he is called Apollyon. The first woe has passed. The whole two woes are still to come. Then the sixth angel blew his trumpet, and I heard a voice from the four horns of the golden altar before God, saying to the sixth angel who had the trumpet, "Release the four angels who are bound at the great river Euphrates." So the four angels who had been prepared for the hour, the day, the month, and the year were released to kill a third of mankind. The number of mounted troops was twice 10,000 times 10,000. I heard their number. And this is how I saw the horses in my vision and those who rode them. They wore breastplates the color of fire and of sapphire. Sulfur. Oh, that sounds cool. And the heads of the horses were like lions' heads. And fire and smoke and sulfur came out of their mouths. By these three plagues, a third of mankind was killed. By the fire and smoke and sulfur coming out of their mouths. The power of the horses is in their mouths and in their tails. For the tails are like serpents with heads. And by means of them they wound. The rest of mankind who were not killed by these plagues did not repent of the works of their hands, nor give up worshiping demons and idols of gold and silver and bronze and stone and wood, which cannot see or hear or walk, nor did they repent of their murders or their sorceries or their sexual immorality or their thefts. And it's not done yet. There's more to this trumpet. But we have to not go on because the genius monks decided this was far enough. So we are going to stop with this much text today. Also keep this in your mind. The seventh trumpet has not yet blown. Wright will handle this by saying there's an interlude. I disagree. I think this is more of the seventh trumpet. Okay, we'll come to that. Let's go back and deal with the fifth trumpet. The fifth trumpet, notice, just a couple of things. I'm going to skim through a couple of verses, and hopefully you can see where it's going. We're going to go back to verse 10 in chapter 8. The third angel blows his trumpet, and a great star falls from heaven. Name's Wormwood. Now, go to 9, verse 1. The fifth angel blew his trumpet, and I saw a star having fallen from heaven. Yeah? Same star. Yeah. And then, skip down to, I gotta find it. Verse 11. They have as king over them the angel of the bottomless pit. Also with a name. Just like the star has a name, bitterness. Well, this angel has a name in Hebrew, one word, and in Greek, the same word. And all you have there as Abaddon and Apollyon are English butcherings of the Hebrew word, not what they mean. In both places, the word means destruction or ruin. So if you want to like really give it a nice feel to it, his name in Hebrew is destruction and in Greek is ruin. Yeah? That's kind of the way it flows. And what I want you you don't have to agree, but I think you will find it makes a lot of sense if you see that this star named Bitterness, who fell from heaven like lightning and is given the name, actually then is given the key to all of the other third of the heavens that fell, the other stars, which clouded light so light isn't full anymore. And they are in fact not just stars, they are angels which have been bound but are unbound for a time. We call them demons, and then he starts talking about what they look like and what they do. Yeah? And that the Lord of these demons is this star, and you know exactly what I'm talking about. Lucifer, as Isaiah spoke of him. Satan, as Jesus called him.
both names that also mean something. Lucifer means bringer of light.
Yeah, kind of like a star.
Satan is a little different. More closely related to bitterness, accuser. Accuser or adversary. And this leader of fallen angels is given the power to rule all fallen angels. He's a king, right? A king of the abyss, bottomless pit, the word's abuso. You hear the word abyss in it? Probably not hell just yet. But sort of, there are other places in Scripture where the apostles speak about God kind of holding the demons in check. Deepest darkness is reserved for them and such. That's kind of what's going on here. Then there's the description. And really, I think, and this is Brian's point as well, that the purpose of this description is just to freak you out. It has no necessary specific thing for each little piece. I mean, maybe you can figure that out, but no one's been able to yet. But why do they have hair like women? Because women are demonic. See, yeah, what are you going to do with it? There's nothing you can do with it. What they are is freaky. Not women. Demons. Demons are freaky. I mean, you think, oh, they look like men, not so bad. They got hair like women, kind of strange, and then they smile, teeth like lions. I mean, it's like the sirens in Greek mythology, only worse. And they go out, and they are given power over. This is really a huge point. This is kind of the main point. Who do they have power over? Everybody? No. Only those who are not sealed with the seal of God, which, if you remember, chapter 7 is all about God not letting anybody die until he has sealed those who he wants to have sealed. And you hear this 144,000, and you see this uncountable number who have the seal of God on their foreheads, and they're praising God. Yeah. The church, the saved, the elect, the Christians. They cannot be tormented in this way by these demons. Because what they are bringing is false spirituality. Self-justification. A life of mankind trapped in his own need to rely on himself. And this is the torment they bring with them. Christians are protected from this by the promises of Christ. They cannot be destroyed needlessly. You don't need to walk around afraid of them, but recognize that everyone else in the world who's not a Christian, the unbaptized, have no defense against this army. And that's the real point there. And there's going to be more of this at the end. Notice how, in spite of these things, and then the next thing, the death that's going to come, nobody repents. If you take that to literally, it means there's no Christians. That's not what it means. It means that those who are not Christians continue to not repent, even though this torment is being brought upon them by these two different armies coming at them. No, we're out of time. So that's the first woe. The first woe is unbelief. Did I draw it in here somewhere? Yeah, I kind of tuck it in up here. Because again, this is connected to the existence which is created by the fall itself. Unbelief of mankind. Those who are not elected to God's church suffer unbelief, literally. And then with the sixth angel, interestingly enough, you have a repeat again. You got these four angels who are being held back at the river Euphrates. Now remember, there's been four angels already being held back in the book of Revelation. It is the four horsemen of the apocalypse who are being held at the four corners of the earth and told that they're not allowed to basically do what they want to the earth, which is to just destroy the entire thing. Instead, there's this one-third thing going on where they're doing torment, but not full torment. Yeah. Death has not just kind of leveled the place entirely. God is sustaining us, all creation. Against death. The same thing has happened here. The river Euphrates, why Euphrates? It was connected to Babylon in the north, which is the place of judgment. Historically, for the Hebrew peoples, there's two things. If you want to talk about judgment coming, you talk about Egypt, you talk about Babylon. Yeah? They are both the examples from their history of where bad things come from. The bad things are being held and they're released, but not released to entirely just destroy everything. They're released to kill one-third of mankind. So, we've heard this before. This is going on up here already. And so all that's happening now is this whole section, I didn't draw this for you, but this whole section is just getting plugged in right down there. And why would he repeat himself? Because there's more to this trumpet. We just haven't heard it yet. It's coming next. Right with this trumpet is going to show up an angel. A special angel. An angel that maybe is not an angel, but more than an angel. The angel of the Lord himself. We'll talk about that and the connections to the Old Testament next week, unless maybe we'll be able to squeeze a
word about it in a moment. I want to make sure I don't forget anything else. The point of all of these troops, again, is that you have these two massive armies that cannot be... No human army could stand against this. Breastplates made of fire? Good luck, right? Goodness gracious. Hold on. I mean, and I think it sounds cool because I can imagine watching the movie, but to actually have to come face-to-face with that? Holy moly. Fire and sapphire. Horses like lions, snakes as their tails. This is crazy. And by these three plagues, a third of mankind is killed. Now that's interesting. Three plagues.
Well,
tyranny, war, famine, death. A third is killed. Yeah. The rest of mankind who were not killed, that is all who remain alive currently, by nature, do not repent and worship demons by worshiping idols, that is, things that are not gods, whether they're made of stone as a face that you bow down to it, or whether it's your portion, which I wouldn't mind having worship, but wouldn't want to worship either. Nor do they repent of their murders, that's their hate, or their sorceries, that's their attempts to manipulate God himself with their prayers, nor their sexual immorality, you know what that is, nor their thefts. I think that covers everything that is the most confusing. Let me just read this next section, 10 verse 1. Then I saw another mighty angel coming down from heaven, wrapped in a cloud. One is the cloud, with a rainbow over his head, that's hint number 2. His face was like the sun, that's hint number 3, and his legs like pillars of fire, that's hint number 4. This angel's going to do some stuff, but who is this angel? Huge question. Classic interpretation said Peter. More modern interpreters that I'm going to agree with say, I don't know if this sounds like Gabriel. Remember the else we know about Gabriel. But it sounds a lot like someone else. Who, I mean, just think, if those of you who are interested this morning, who speaks from clouds?
God.
Yeah. From the early part of the book itself, who had legs like burnished bronze?
Jesus.
Yeah, Jesus and God the Father on his throne. Jesus is going to have it at the end of the book. He has it back in Daniel. Whose face on the day of transfiguration shone like the sun?
Jesus.
And who set the rainbow in the skies and promise of salvation?
God.
So who is this angel? Just an angel? Or is he paying tribute to a phrase from the Old Testament? It's the phrase, the angel of the Lord, who, don't have time to make that to prove the case, but there is almost universal consensus in a conservative interpretation of the Bible. The angel of the Lord is the pre-incarnate Jesus. Easiest example, Jacob wrestles with him at the Jabbok River. He wrestles with the angel of the Lord. And afterwards he says, behold, I have seen God and lived. There it is. The angel of the Lord is not just an angel. He is the speaker for God, messenger of the Lord, who is, how does God intermediate with man? Always through his Son, who then takes on flesh for our sake. So now what he's seen is this angel of the Lord. Remember, this is why I put it all here at this this point of fall creating the tribulation, because now this angel of the Lord is entering into the history too. And we're going to learn things about who he is, what he has done, what he's going to do as we move forward through this sixth and seventh trumpet. So the sixth and seventh trumpet are really going to be the history of God's salvation in the midst of everything we've seen in this tribulation. We have to, not go to it because it's just too much today. Yeah? I think I can squeeze in, two questions if you got it. Yeah.
Maybe you answered this already, but on the sixth trumpet, the third of mankind, does that not include those who still have the seal?
It moves to everybody, right? Because it's death. So the unbelievers are being tormented spiritually. They're suffering unbelief, literally. And now all mankind is suffering death. So in one sense, what is the Christian spared from? The second death. Right? You are born again. Born to new life of faith. So that first one isn't hitting you. You can cast yourself in with him again. That's a different thing. As opposed to the physical death, which is being brought about by these four other angels with their plagues, three plagues, death itself. Now, good. I just cannot believe there's not a question.
You guys are just afraid.
Yeah, Peter, ask me.
As I'm wrapping my brain around this, there's a more common question. One of the things I'm discovering is the reason it's hard to wrap my brain around this is because I've been taught the pre-money of sensationalism, and I have to basically make my mind up a blank slate and start over.
Yeah.
Kind of think everything I know is wrong, put that all aside and start over. So
that's
kind of what I'm doing.
For sure. Because we're so used to wanting it to be a book about this little tiny period where maybe we're alive and we can see it. Yeah, but hopefully not. You know? As opposed to being a sermon about Jesus that John is preaching, using symbolic, that is, code language because of the oppression and persecution which he and the other Christians are enduring. Does that mean he didn't actually have a vision? I'm not going to say that. He says he had a vision, he had a vision. The vision is of what we already believe. He's writing to those in the midst of a world that's going to try to destroy them, saying, don't stop believing. You enter it that way, through the Lamb himself. You do, you come with a very different picture. What I'm trying to do is find a way to look at that that takes it outside of the newspaper print history book style that all of us have grown up. I grew up with it too. It's a real challenge. What I find is the more I look at it, it's like, wow, this does make sense. And we're still going there. We're not there yet, but you'll see. And it's all about Jesus and his cross. And that's when you start to go, oh, well, maybe this is, maybe it should be looked at this way. Because the one thing that this tends to not be about is Jesus and his cross. Yeah. All right. Cool. Let us pray. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Lord God in heaven, we thank you for Jesus and his cross. That you have protected us from the final effects of all of these catastrophes and woes which you have justly sent upon our earth. And in him you have bought us again, sealed us with his name, and have given us a promise that on the last day when he returns, we will enter into the victory feast of eternity. As we wait in the midst of this great tribulation, help us to understand where we are, to know the meaning of the days which are evil, to count our days. Teach us also then to, with our words, our lives, speak of this truth to each other in the midst of this congregation, our families at home, and to those abroad and beyond us, that more and more will lift up their eyes and see Jesus and his cross, that together we will feast on that last day when you come again. We pray this for Jesus' sake. Amen.
Amen.
Thanks for your time.
Thank you, Pastor.